Extraordinary events. Hello, everyone. I'm Giselle Fernandez. Tonight, we expose a range of these claims to science. And as we take you live around the world in our search for answers and subject these reported signs from God to thorough expert analysis, we invite you, the viewer, to take your place on the jury. Prepare to hear and see what until now cannot be explained. Prepare to witness those whose lives seem to be suddenly marked by signs from God. In a world where natural disasters increase in size and power, and mystical events seize every continent, join us for an investigation of divine consequences. Is this a warning for the new millennium, or predictable hysteria at century's end? Tonight, we take you to Mexico, where images weep and art suddenly flowers on the petal of a rose. And from Bolivia, you'll see a statue apparently painted in sorrow by its own blood, and a woman seemingly near death from the wounds of Christ's crucifixion. Are these and other phenomena a massive organized fraud, or the most important story of our time? Tonight, our experts examine what seems impossible. Is there an answer? What is the truth? What can you believe? Tonight, live, Signs from God, Science Tests Faith. Tonight, as Science Tests Faith, as we hear about those who believe they receive messages from God, we will be taking you live to a most exotic location, the city of Cochabamba in Bolivia, deep in the center of South America. Here, we will meet Katya Rivas, the most important subject of our investigation tonight. We will test her alleged visionary powers and observe extreme mystical phenomena in her house. We will also be taking you live to Forensic Analytical in Hayward, California, just outside of Oakland. We'll be getting results of samples taken from the wounds of an alleged stigmata and a statue which seems to bleed on its own. In Monterrey, Mexico, we will go live to the home of Mila Carrasco, where intricate religious images are said to suddenly appear on delicate rose petals. And we'll take you live to a laboratory at UC Davis to get the verdict of experts on the authenticity of those mysterious petals. We'll be talking with a veteran art curator and a noted botanist. And watching with us live from Mount Pocono, Pennsylvania, a Catholic Church authority, Father Peter Stravinskas. Welcome to Fox Studios in Los Angeles. The show you are about to watch was 7 years in the making. It is about people who did not in any way seek our attention, and it is about an internationally respected journalist who won their trust and found himself then changed in the process. His name is Michael Willesee. What an honor it is to work alongside you.
Thanks, Giselle.
I understand from all the noteworthy work that you've done over the years where you're renowned for your skepticism and investigative abilities, this is not only different, this project we're about to see has been extraordinary for you.
It started 7 years ago for me through a lawyer who started this investigation, and I simply did not believe most of what he told me. A lot of things have happened since then. It's been an extraordinary journey, and I'd like our viewers to join us on that journey.
Get us started. Who are you going to introduce us to first?
Well, in fact, at first, this search for signs of God was less about faith and more about fraud. On two occasions, I investigated claims where miracles were said to be taking place, and both proved to be phony. Then about 12 months ago, I visited Bolivia. There, I was struck by a lack of ego, cult, or money-making. And I was impressed by a woman who seemed to be very special.
In Bolivia, in the very center of the South American continent, lives a woman named Katya Rivas. She is one of the chosen. She says she hears and sees Jesus and the Virgin Mary. Now, if Katya is telling the truth, then firstly, why her?
Cuando el Señor me habló, yo sí le pregunté al Señor, ¿por qué a mí? I did ask the Lord, why me? And the Lord replied, if there were in the world a more needy person, a poorer and more wretched person than you, I would have chosen that person.
When we heard claims of supernatural phenomena taking place in Katya's house, we took our cameras to investigate. Almost immediately, a statue of the Virgin Mary began to weep oil. But if we thought this was astonishing, on our second visit, we were shocked into suspending belief. This is a simple framed print of Our Lady of Guadalupe. It hangs in Katya's hallway. But on March 25, 1999, something truly inexplicable occurred. We witnessed and filmed a gathering of thousands of coloured crystals on the image, bright and exquisite in their artistic formation, and no evidence of the hand of man. So there is more to Katya than her claims of heavenly messages. However, her past gives few clues of the happenings of today. Her childhood was relatively ordinary, and in adulthood, she was sometimes troubled, married three times, and not devoted to God. But in 1993, she found herself turning to prayer. Katya says it was the Virgin Mary who first spoke to her.
Were you satisfied your sanity was okay?
Me asusté.
I was scared, and I thought I was sick and needed the help of a psychologist or a psychiatrist.
Katya asked herself why and for what purpose. The answer, she says, came from Jesus himself.
I asked, what do you want from me, my Lord? He said, be calm. What I need is to convey messages to humanity through you. This is why my mother has been preparing you.
Katya says she then started receiving messages from Jesus and writing them down. She writes in a beautiful but simple style about complex issues concerning life, spirituality, and theology. 9 books in all, and sometimes in languages unknown to Katya, like Polish, Greek, and Latin. All this from a woman who never finished high school. Her bishop took the exceptional step of approving her writings, giving them the imprimatur of the church. Katya was also assigned a spiritual director, Father Renzo Cecilo. As we continued to visit Katya at her home, the artistic glitter on the picture of Mary continued to grow and change. On the third night, we noticed part of the image illuminated in the dark. We then bathed the image in a strong television light, the same area lit up into a brilliant phosphorus green. To us, a mystery. But to Katya, it was simple. A gift from Jesus and a message. This was the womb of Mary, where he became man.
Well, already we are left with so many questions. But what I find remarkable is that this woman, Katya, doesn't even have a high school education, and she was able to write in so many different languages, including Greek.
Her writing's beyond our understanding. Katya writes nonstop, line after line, page after page, and it's theologically sound. It's intelligent, it's elegant, it's poetic, and in all these languages. Specifically, I said, how can you write in Greek when you don't even know the characters? And she said, quite simply, Jesus shows me these characters.
And they have been authenticated, you said in the piece, by the church.
Yes, her bishop has given her the imprimatur for her writings.
All right, we've set the scene, Michael, but already we have a lot of viewers out there who are watching and are already skeptical. What do you say to them?
Oh, look, I understand exactly where they're coming from. I was there, I was very skeptical, but I would just suggest they hold fire, at least until the next segment, where we do test Katya, And the results are stunning.
All right, which leads us to this question. Can a sign from God be detected by advanced medical technology? We will let you be the judge next when we show you an intriguing story of science and faith. Welcome back to Signs from God. How do you test someone like Katya Rivas, who claims to hear the voice of God? Michael Willesee discovered that a Dr. Ricardo Castañón, a Bolivian psychologist, had managed to document a change in brain activity while alleged visionaries like Katya claimed to be receiving messages. Now, using an EEG, universally regarded as the most sensitive neurological test available, Castañón documented these visionaries experiencing something called the Delta State while awake and communicating. Now, that is significant and previously thought impossible. The neurology textbooks will tell you that people reach the Delta State only when they are sleeping or in a coma. Significant for you as a journalist because you needed a test, is that right?
Giselle, we saw this as a very big opportunity in our investigation because we had so many religious claims. Now we had what appeared to be scientific claims supporting them.
Mm-hmm.
So we wanted to test for ourselves to see if Katya's EEG would record the very slow delta waves while she was conscious. We decided the only way to know was to take her to a neurologist who had no idea why we wanted the test done.
March 10, 1999, and Mexico City has been chosen as the location for our independent tests. The Angeles Hospital is one of Mexico City's eminent medical facilities. Dr. Victor Pella is head of the neurology department and one of Mexico's most respected neurologists. He has never met any of us before and is not aware of our purpose.
Doctor, do you know why you were testing this patient?
No.
It might be the biggest test of her life, but you wouldn't know watching Katya as the electrodes put in place. She is remarkably calm.
Has it occurred to you that if you don't give us the results that we're looking for, you might feel you're letting somebody down?
No. I know the Lord is with me, and he will do whatever is necessary.
So that makes you confident?
Sí. Yes, always.
The EEG will measure and record the electrical impulses generated by the nerve cells in Katya's brain. What we are looking for in today's test are the extremely slow delta brain waves. As Katya says, she is in contact with Jesus. Katya's spiritual director, Father Renzo, and Dr. Castañón will stay with Katya throughout. Isolated in an adjoining room is Dr. Pella. Now, it's important to note that at no time will Katya or Dr. Castañón be aware of the EEG reading, nor will they be able to hear anything Dr. Pella says during the test.
Relax yourself and begin to pray.
After 20 minutes, routine tests have shown Katya's brain is healthy. But as she prays, her brain waves slow significantly on the left-hand side. It's abnormal, and Dr. Pella speculates on the possible cause.
We could think from the neurological point of view that it could be epilepsy, if there is no tumor.
What you are saying, doctor, is abnormal.
This part?
Abnormal.
Abnormal. This part?
Father will give you the picture of Jesus so that you can see him and pray.
It is now that a significant turning point occurs. Katya claims her first vision.
Our Lord is present.
Or do you see him?
Standing here.
As Katya takes the Holy Communion, the most extraordinary EEG readings begin. Her brain waves slow to the delta state, the unusually slow activity only seen in people in extremely deep sleep or coma.
This is very abnormal.
He's only looking at me.
As Katya describes the vision, the delta waves continue.
More deltas.
Katya has hit the delta state, and yet she is alert and communicating with Dr. Castagnon. Dr. Pella has never seen this before.
We must trust him.
Now, that is pretty amazing, because now you've got scientific evidence that her brainwaves do change when she says she's receiving messages from God. Astounding for you to be there?
Yeah, it seemed very important. It seemed basic, it seemed factual, and we certainly couldn't understand it. And the point is, neurologists could not explain what happened. They say the delta state doesn't allow for that. But what happened next surprised us much, much more. Keep this in mind. Katya was in a sealed room. She could not hear what Dr. Pella was saying at any time. It was therefore impossible that they could hold a conversation.
We could think from the neurological point of view that it could be epilepsy.
A few minutes after Dr. Pella has speculated Katya could have epilepsy, Katya says she receives a message from Christ. Now remember, Katya is isolated from the monitoring room and has no possible way of knowing anything Dr. Pella has said.
I have nothing wrong. Nothing wrong.
When Dr. Castagnon asks Katya what she means, she pauses and then says,
they know it. They know this.
It then becomes clear she is talking directly to the testing neurologist Dr. Pella, apparently on instructions from Jesus. Incredibly, they begin a conversation.
Do you think I am epileptic?
Dr. Pella answers.
Well, because of that malformation, I would think so.
And Katya responds.
Jesus says I am not epileptic.
Understandably, Dr. Pella is astounded by the sequence of events.
Do you want more proof?
When she answered me, I felt something strange in my body. I think I had an outstanding experience, and I cannot explain it. I feel something in myself.
I don't know.
Now, Michael, you are absolutely sure they could not hear each other. They were in separate rooms.
Giselle, I was there, and when I started to realize that a conversation was taking place and there was a soundproof wall between them, the hairs on the back of my neck stood up. I think it was the first time in my life that I simply couldn't even find a question.
So this was a turning point for you in the filming of this documentary?
It made me think very, very seriously.
All right, let's ask the church what it thinks. How does the Catholic Church view people such as Katya? And what would the church think of putting faith to the test as we have? Father Peter Stravinskas is the editor of The Catholic Answer, the author of 21 books, and founder of what you might call a Catholic think tank. And he joins us now from Mount Pocono, Pennsylvania. Father Stravinskas, thank you so much for being with us tonight.
Pleasure to be with you.
Father, first let me ask you what your reaction is to what you've just seen from Katya.
Well, it's impressive, it's interesting, and I guess to lead into the next question would be, what's my attitude? I think mine would be that of the church. What's the church's? It's the attitude of Christ, which is to say that initially there's a skepticism to all of this. Our Lord tells us several times in the Gospels, an evil generation seeks a sign. In other words, we're supposed to be able to believe without external evidence or supernatural phenomena. Our Lord speaks to St. Thomas a week after his resurrection and says, blessed are they who have believed but have not seen. That having been said, that once a person alleges to have had some kind of mystical, supernatural experience, the Church believes that such a thing is possible, but highly improbable.
So, Katya, could be used as an instrument of thy peace. It's possible.
It's possible that it's from God. It's possible that it's from the devil. It's possible that it's from a sick mind, or even worse, perhaps, someone who's engaged in fraud.
Father, I've got to say your answer confuses me, because Jesus Christ himself was a man of great signs. Fatima was about signs. Padre Pio, who was recently beatified, was a stigmatist. He was about signs. So what you say confuses me.
The presumption is that these extraordinary phenomena are not the way God normally works to communicate his will or his way. Jesus became very, very upset when people conditioned belief, demanded particular signs in order to believe. God is able, God is the Lord of nature. And as the Lord of nature, he normally prefers to work through nature. At the same time, as the Lord of nature, he can suspend the laws of nature in order to communicate an extraordinary message or to get mankind's attention in a particular way.
Well, I agree with you. I think we've gotten mankind's attention tonight. And Father, we will be checking back with you a little bit later for more of your expert analysis on this subject. And we will return to Los Angeles as well with more signs from God. We're back with Signs from God. As you know, there are many books discrediting these kind of phenomena, and one of the biggest questions is why these mystical events seem confined to the poor from small, out-of-the-way Catholic countries. But in recent times, reports of visions and other related phenomena have in fact been surprisingly widespread.
Fatima, Portugal, 1917. Three shepherd children claim to speak to the Virgin Mary on the 13th day of every month. Her messages carried dire warnings. Thousands that came to witness her appearances claim they actually saw the sun dance during the apparition. Garabando, Spain. It's the early 1960s, and four peasant girls have seen visions of angels and the Virgin Mary. To the amazement of witnesses, the girls appear to defy natural law. They levitate. Here, they are apparently receiving Holy Communion from an angel visible only to them. In this photo, some believe you can actually see the host on the girl's tongue. Later in the decade, apparitions of the Virgin Mary appear above a church in Muslim Egypt. The apparitions continue for 3 years, witnessed by more than 1 million people of every denomination. It's 1973, and something quite extraordinary is happening in Japan. In a country where 99% of the population is non-Christian, a statue of the Virgin Mary has started to weep. Tests done at the University of Akita confirm the tears are human. A decade later in South Korea, mother of four, Julia Kim, converts from Buddhism to Christianity. She begins to have holy visions, and to the astonishment of witnesses, wounds inexplicably appear on her hands and feet, stigmata. More than a decade before the breakup of Yugoslavia, six young Croatians say they're receiving messages from the Virgin Mary. They warn of global catastrophe if mankind does not repair its ways. The messages of Medjugorje continue to be reported today. From 1981 to 1989, in the heart of Africa, the Virgin appears to seven young people, sometimes as predicted, at a given day, a given time. All the young people say they see rivers of blood in horrifying visions. 2 years after the incidents end, 1 million Rwandans are massacred in a civil war. And in the last decade of the final century of the millennium, it is alleged the Virgin Mother has come to Conyers, Georgia. Messages are delivered on the 13th of the month, as in Fatima. A crowd of 150,000 arrives in 1998 for the final message. Traffic to the small town is backed up for 100 miles. Stop offending God, they are told. You have yet to see the forces of nature. If you choose to live apart from God, then you will fall.
And tonight in Bolivia, we have cameras focused live on several objects that have produced mystical phenomena, including a statue which seems to weep oil. Now, is there a way to assess if any of these visionaries associated with these events are telling the truth? Dr. Ricardo Castañan, who formulated the EEG test we saw used earlier on Katya Rivas, and who was present that day at the hospital in Mexico City, is just back from a tour of Asia where he investigated other visionaries, and he joins us now live from Bolivia. Buenas noches, Dr. Castañan. Welcome.
Good evening. Glad to see you, and thank you for this invitation.
Such a great pleasure. I imagine you come across a lot of frauds in your work. How many do you find to be genuine?
I have studied around 50 cases in the four continents, and from them, 6 cases were false. Then it's not, as some people say, everyone is false. I think that before we talk and we say, I am a skeptic or I don't believe this, we must go very deep with the information to know if that's truth or not. The most of the cases I have studied were authentic.
Now, of the authentic ones that you've deemed authentic, what do they have in common, if anything?
Well, when we study the cases, you have seen only some part of the technical results we get. But normally, we have to study the life of these people. They are people who try to have a holy life. They are humble. They are not looking for money. When I was studying cases in America, the first question is if they get money or not. I have to tell you that these people are very, very simple. They have a quiet life. They pray a lot. They want to help pilgrims. They want to help people. But I have to say also that it's very important to know as a warning that some people were authentic for some years, but because their human weaknesses, they were not able to keep a holy life, and then they changed it and they wanted money, copyrights. They said the messages belonged to them. Then they didn't have a holy life. And that's the reason why the church is very prudent, not only to say if they are authentic or not, but also to see if they keep a holy life.
Dr. Castañan, just briefly, a few short years back, you were an atheist. Now, what's happened to the certainty you once held that God did not exist?
For me, it's important to say that during the 80s, I was living in Germany. And during 10 years, I was hearing that in many countries, Jesus and Mary were appearing. But I didn't see that the science was trying to give an answer to this. For this, you saw that Father Peter said it could be a fraud, it could be this, it could be this. Important for science is to say, is it or it's not? Then I decided to study these cases as an atheist to give some orientation to the people, because it's very easy to say it's truth, maybe or maybe not. It's important to say to the people the truth. And the truth showed me that there is a spirit, that these miracles are happening, and now I believe in this spirit.
Thank you
and
so much.
And in these cases also.
Muchísimas gracias for your intuition and your guidance. Thank you, Dr. Castañan.
Thank you very much.
Michael's investigation uncovered other so-called signs from God as well. Our next story involves the testing of a statue of Jesus Christ in Bolivia. The claim is straightforward, that the statue on its own bleeds. Now, this is a live shot of that statue. We put this statue to the test, the highest test, the CAT scan, to determine if it had been tampered with in any way. And you'll see those results and something else that seems to happen to this statue. Something beyond science when we come right back.
It is decorated with artistic markings that depict his blood. In 1995, Emma Orobola's family bought one of these statues and placed it on an altar in their home. Just hours later, the family said they were shocked to discover the statue was crying. A short time later, they said, this incredible statue of Christ began to bleed. When we heard these reports, we flew to Cochabamba in Bolivia to test for ourselves. This is what we saw. If you look closely at this footage, you can see that a tear has started to form an inch below the right eye. The tear moves slowly down the cheek and eventually falls. We continued to film for hours with nobody able to touch the statue. And this was the result. Inexplicably, the statue began to bleed. We now had our first major forensic challenge. If this was not a fraud, then where was this blood coming from? Whose blood was it? Was it human? And what of the DNA? What would that reveal? We took a sample of this substance, which has the appearance of blood. Whatever the results of our tests, Cochabamba's local archbishop has accepted the authenticity of this statue, which is now venerated by the thousands of people who have seen it cry and bleed. But of course, if this is a fraud, there is one obvious possibility, and that is the statue has been tampered with. A device, an injection, some type of hoax devised by man. Emma's family agreed to let science test the statue. A CAT scan was chosen for the test, the same sophisticated probe which allows doctors to see what X-rays cannot. If there was so much as a pinprick in this statue, it would be revealed by a CAT scan. The result? The statue has no devices, no holes, not the tiniest of apertures. It has not been tampered with. Science has no explanation for the weeping or bleeding. Since it began to bleed, the face has changed. It now appears etched with the suffering of a man dying in extreme pain. Today, it is hard to believe this statue was once an exact replica of the one you see on the right of the screen. The eyes no longer look like plaster, but indicate the reality of a tortuous death. Now it's time to test the blood from this tortured face.
Welcome back to Fox Studios in Los Angeles, everyone. You've just seen a statue of Jesus Christ apparently covered by its own blood, and now we're going to put this sign of God to the test of science. Lisa Calandro is an expert in blood and DNA analysis, and she works with many of California's biggest police departments. Ms. Calandro is standing by live at Forensic Analytical just outside Oakland, and we thank you so much, Ms. Calandro, for joining us this evening.
Good evening, Giselle, Mike.
Let us first ask you, we gave you a substance that had the appearance of dried blood. How do you go about testing a substance when you don't know its origin?
Well, we approached it like we approach any forensic sample. First, we examine it visually, and in this case, it was a very small, approximately half centimeter squared dried crust with some red material on it. We subjected that material to a chemical test for the presence of blood, and from there we characterized the blood to determine whether or not it was human.
And what did you find?
We did find that it was human blood, and then we subsequently used DNA testing methods to determine that the blood originated from a female.
Well, I guess that's all we need to know, Lisa, as surprising as that is. Thanks, and we'll talk to you a little bit later.
Thank you.
But that does leave me with a question for you, Mike. They found human female blood on this statue. What does that tell us?
It doesn't tell me anything. I really don't know, but I could hazard a guess. I stress, it's just a guess. If you believe in the theory or the teaching of the Immaculate Conception, then Jesus had a mother but no father. If he is of the flesh of his mother, could Jesus be of the blood of his mother?
It's perhaps one of the most creative theories I've heard in a long time. Would not hold up, as you know, in a court of law, but we have to remind you that this statue put in a CAT scan did not reveal any tampering whatsoever. So we have to keep on testing. And I guess we have to keep searching for these signs of God and ask this question. Is it possible for science to test faith? We take you to a home in Mexico where Michael found several events that seemed to defy reason. You're going to take us, what, to Mila's house now, Mike?
Yeah, really, this is where it all started. In one small house in Monterrey, Mexico, we heard reports of a religious image appearing through the concrete floor, a picture of the Virgin Mary which shed tears before a variety of witnesses, and rose petals somehow revealing religious images. This was indeed an opportunity to see, to touch, to test.
Here is a special woman. Her name is Mila. Mila and her family live in a humble, bare, two-bedroom house. In the altar of the front room, Mila prays. And the results of those prayers are completely beyond our understanding. It is in the house of Mila our investigations begin. How would you react if you were mopping the floor and an image started to appear and you can't remove it? In fact, as Mila continued to scrub, the image actually became stronger. It appears to be Our Lady of Guadalupe, the most famous religious icon of Latin America. The image dominates Mila's floor and today continues to grow. It was back in April 1996 that other inexplicable supernatural events were claimed in Mila's house. One day, as she prayed, Mila says a picture of Jesus Christ started to cry. Today, the marks, consistent with tears, remain. When my crew and I arrived at Mila's house, we witnessed an extraordinary happening. On a picture of the Virgin Mary, a drop like a tear appeared. The important point with this image, which is sandwiched between two pieces of glass, is that when you turn it around, there is no room in there for any device which could fabricate weeping. But there is another amazing phenomenon occurring in Mila's house. Mila's front room has become a full-time chapel for the believers of Monterrey. When they pray here, they often bring roses. The petals collect on the altar. Some of the petals seem to reveal intricate mystical images. A reward, says Mila, for faith and prayer. But is that the truth?
In this one,
Mila says the images appear on the petals after she and other believers place them in their Bibles or prayer books. She says some take just a few hours to appear, others may develop over a number of weeks.
At first, we had this petal inside a book, and it had nothing on it. And then we prayed the rosary, and this image appeared.
Isn't it beautiful?
And each one is clearly different in size,
yeah.
Different in image.
Yeah.
So it would be very difficult to see how this could be manufactured with such variety.
There are various images which appear to be of Jesus and the Virgin Mary. Here is Our Lady of Guadalupe.
This is a fresh image. This image, I'm told, is only 4 days old. They're different images, but so similar, and both only a few days old.
Mila's faith in the heavenly authenticity of her images was impressive. When I asked her if we could submit these images to the tests of scientists and experts in art fraud, She readily agreed.
Do you care what those tests will tell us?
Well, I believe yes. It would be a good idea. It would be proof that all that is happening here is true.
That's a lot of faith and a lot of confidence. Now let's go live to Mila's house in Monterey to see if any of the phenomena we just saw are occurring tonight. Standing by, our reporter, Sandra Cuba. Sandra, buenos noches. Welcome. Thanks for joining us this evening. You've been there a week. Have you seen firsthand any of this phenomena occurring?
Well, Giselle, I'll tell you, when we first arrived here on Monday to meet Mila, who's standing right by my side, we found this picture of the Virgin Mary weeping. On that day, there were local residents here in this house praying, and according to Mila, it wept seven times. Today, since we've been here to set up for this broadcast, we found the Virgin Mary weeping. Second time we saw it, it started weeping. And the last time it wept, it was about a little bit over an hour ago. But aside from this amazing phenomena that's taking place in this house, there's also the rose petals. Rose petals that Mila Carrasco claims. Images appear on these rose petals when they're placed in a Bible. I'm going to place this one here so you can take a better look at it. This is an image of our Virgin Mary. ¿Qué tan reciente es este pétalo? How recent is this petal?
De marzo.
This is from March. This petal here is from March. She claims when you place these rose petals inside a Bible, images appear. Do they always appear? Cada vez que usted pone un pétalo en la Biblia, ¿aparece una imagen?
Bueno, no siempre. A veces cuando está uno rezando el rosario.
She says not necessarily, but mostly it does appear when everyone is here gathered praying the rosary. Today, however, we have brought our own Bible, and we're going to place rose petals inside this Bible. You only put them inside, it doesn't matter what page you put them on. No importa qué página usted ponga los pétalos de rosa.
Sí, no importa.
Voy a poner varios pétalos aquí. I'm going to place several rose petals in here, and we're going to keep an eye on these rose petals. Should anything happen, we'll be right here to show you. Giselle?
Sandra, thank you so much. We will be in Mexico live all night, and we will take you right back to Monterey if there is further activity at Mila's house. Now, tonight, we are not going to just take these claims at face value, as we've told you. It is our intention to test these phenomena. And in the case of Mila's rose petal, though, how do you judge the authenticity of something so unique? After the break, we'll not only show you how, we'll give you the results. We're back in a moment from Los Angeles. Welcome back to the Fox Studios in Los Angeles, everyone. As we've been telling you all evening, it is our intention tonight to try and test what we are calling perhaps signs of God from the experts. So let's go to the experts. Will Shank is an art conservator whose resume includes work at renowned museums in London, Madrid, and here in the United States. For two decades, he's been an expert on how to preserve and protect some of the world's greatest art treasures. It's a job that requires him to intimately understand how these works were made. We now join him in a laboratory at the University of California at Davis. And Mr. Shank, thank you so much for joining us tonight.
My pleasure, Giselle.
Let's talk first about these rose petals. When you first heard about these images appearing on these very delicate petals, what was your first reaction?
Well, I was skeptical, but I'm also a believer in phenomena that can't be explained rationally, and I was hoping that this might be one of those cases. I am, however, an analytical kind of guy.
Okay, being analytical, however, when you first saw them, what first surprised you most?
What surprised me most was that they were not random patterns. It was not the case of maybe it is, maybe it's not, but it was very clearly an image of the Virgin of Guadalupe, for instance, on the rose petal that I examined.
So did you believe then automatically these are the work of man?
Automatically, that's what suggested itself to me, but I wanted to get as much information as I could about how they were made.
Will, you've tried yourself to place images on rose petals. What happened? What were your results?
Yes, I have. I can show you the results.
Yeah, good.
What we're actually looking at here is one of Mila Carrasco's rose petals from Monterey that's shot in strong light coming from behind, so that you see what's most distinctive about the image is there is no paint on it, nothing's been applied to the rose petal, but the lighter area here of the image of the Virgin is much thinner than the surrounding area of the rose petal that hasn't been affected by the image. So it suggests that something has been pressed into the rose petal to make the white areas thinner.
Okay.
So in order to gain more information, I looked at it in another sort of light. This is a very strong light coming from the side, we call a raking light, and here you can see the texture of the rose petal. So again, you see the valleys where the Virgin is and the peaks where the Virgin is not, suggesting again that something has been pressed into the rose petal to make the image of the Virgin thinner.
Mr. Schenck, the fingerprint that you show us, could that not be the holding of the petals, or does it necessarily indicate that they were pressed with the finger as opposed to being pressed into a book, a Bible?
I think the fingerprint you're referring to, Giselle, is this series of patterns here, and in fact, I think it's extremely unlikely that casual handling could result in that sort of impression.
And Will, your attempt?
My attempt, you see here, this is actually an image that I created on a rose petal, and with the help of colleagues and friends, I experimented with everything that I thought might be available in a modest dwelling in Mexico without any sort of sophisticated technology. I tried heat, I tried acids in the form of lime juice, I tried bases in the form of household bleach in order to create an image using the sort of metal milagros and ex votos and other objects commonly available in Mexico. I got these at my neighborhood botanica, and this image that you're seeing here of the Sacred Heart was actually created by heating an image like this and pressing it into the flesh of a rose petal. I think it's fairly convincing.
Well, a very interesting attempt. Thank you so much, Will Schenck, for joining us.
Just Michael? Before we lose Will, just one quick one, Will. When we turn Mila's petals around and see from the reverse side, they're basically the same image. What happens when we turn yours around and look from the back?
They're virtually identical front and back, except reversed, because it is all about the transparency of the rose petal.
All right, thank you.
You can see through it.
Thank you so much again, not only for your attempt, but for joining us this evening. Michael, one expert, Will Schenck, says, could be man-made, shows us his rendition. What do you think?
Well, I mean, this is part of the testing process, and you know, I guess it doesn't completely answer it. Why don't we let's get a botanist.
Another expert, you'd like another expert
let's try
perspective,
again.
I agree. We have an expert botanist standing by, also at UC Davis, a PhD in biology. Professor Michael Reed has done extensive research into the molecular analysis of plant life. And with our very special camera, you will be seeing what he has seen when he gives Mila's rose petals thorough microscopic examination. Dr. Reed, thank you so much for joining us as well.
Nice to be with you, Giselle, Mike.
More than anyone else, you know how delicate, how very flimsy and delicate these rose petals are. Were you surprised by these beautiful images that appeared on them?
I was intrigued by the images, Giselle, but I would say that rose petals are not that delicate. We all know about people wearing roses at balls and parties, and rose petals being thrown through the air. In fact, a rose petal is an object that has a surface that's a very flexible skin, like plastic.
So more durable than we would think. You subjected these petals to some pretty thorough analysis, I understand. Can you tell us how you tested them, show us, and then tell us what you were looking for?
Yes, Giselle. Like Will, I thought probably it was possible to reproduce what we saw in Mila's petals by pressing them against the medallion. If you like, I'll show you how I did that.
Please, thank you.
I took a petal and just took a medallion and pressed it against the petal.
Yep.
And then I could look at it in a microscope and see pretty much exactly the same sort of pattern that was seen in Mila's pictures. So here is a virgin and child, for example.
Say again.
And you can see the cleared area where the metal is pressed against the spongy tissue inside the rose petal.
Well, it looks quite similar to the petals that we have from Monterey. Did you detect any processing that could give us some more definitive answers?
Not really, Giselle. The petals are, of course, dried, and one that I received was encapsulated in plastic. that petals that I've made 3 weeks ago and put in my Bible, a botanical book, show images that are quite similar to the ones that we saw in the petals from Mexico.
Dr. Reed, thank you so much for joining us this evening.
You're welcome.
Again, Michael, an expert says perhaps man-made. Any motive in Monterey for making these up?
Well, it's the human nature aspect of it still intrigues me. We now see that man can make them. We don't know if God isn't also making them. If these images are a fraud, you have to ask why these rose petals are not for sale, you know, why they're such precious objects, and why the secret is held. There are a lot of people down there, a lot of them are poor people, they could do with some money. If it's a secret, they're not telling. And
you didn't see them for sale at all?
You can't buy them, and we worked very hard to get to.
All righty. What is the reaction from Monterey to the test of science? Let's rejoin Sandra Cuba live in Mexico. Sandra, you've heard the results. I'm sure you shared them now with Mila. Could they be man-made? Does she believe that?
Mila, la pregunta que te quieren hacer, los expertos dijeron que sí se pueden duplicar calentando una medalla hacia, con un pétalo de rosa. ¿Qué usted opina?
Mira, nosotros, o sea, han estado apareciendo de repente así en la Biblia. Y yo digo que estas son señales, pues, de Dios o de la Virgen.
She truly believes that they're signs from God. She says everyone else has the right to believe what they want, but she knows what happens in her house, and they are a sign from God.
Thank you.
Mike?
Thank you so very much, Sandra, and please give our thanks as well to Mila Carrasco.
Will do.
We move now to what is perhaps the most disturbing and compelling of the alleged signs from God, the stigmata. The person who experiences this is believed to be suffering literally the anxiety and the wounds of Christ as he was crucified. Now, Michael, you had heard reports that Katya Rivas had experienced and suffered through the stigmata before, and you were determined, were you not, to get this on camera?
Yeah, and in fact, we interviewed a doctor who said that he'd witnessed Katya having what appeared to be a stigmata, and she exhibited the vital signs of a person who was dying. He said that the wounds were real, but incredibly had healed when he examined her the next day. I thought it was essential for this story that we film the experience for ourselves, and our first attempt became in itself part of the story.
2,000 years ago, a man suffered an agonizing death. Nails were driven through his hands and feet, a spear pierced his side, and a crown of thorns was forced upon his head. The injuries and suffering of Jesus Christ have been known to manifest themselves in ordinary men and women. It's the phenomenon called stigmata. St. Francis of Assisi reputedly suffered the stigmata in the year 1224. The marks that appeared on his hands, feet and side remained with him until his death. The stigmata continues to inspire awe and amazement. In May of this year, a crowd well in excess of 1 million people gathered in Rome for the beatification of Padre Pio. For 50 years, the late Padre Pio bled from supernatural wounds to his hands and feet. The Vatican has only authenticated 12 cases of stigmata. Case number 13 may prove to be Katya Rivas. We began our investigation of stigmata in Bolivia at Easter. We believed that Katya's stigmata could happen on Good Friday, the day of Christ's crucifixion. If this was to happen, we would be ready to film it and take samples of blood for laboratory testing. But as we began filming, Katya says she received another message for us from Jesus.
Dirán a Ron y Mike. Tell Mike that maybe this is not the moment or time to take the samples you are looking for.
There would be no stigmata. We had come all the way to Bolivia, it seems, for nothing. And we were disappointed. But the messages continue.
Learn to trust in me more. This is not the right time.
According to this message, the stigmata would happen in Jesus' time, not ours. Our patients, we were told, would be rewarded.
You ready?
Ready?
Greg? Katya, are you ready?
The following day came an incredible prophecy. As we were setting up for an interview with Katya, she interrupted to say she had received a new message from Jesus.
In reference to Mike, he will see more marvelous things through me.
Not only would there be a full stigmata, but the exact date it would occur was stated in the message.
The day after the day of Corpus Christi.
No maybes, no conditions. This was our first specific prophecy.
So we can expect stigmata after Corpus Christi?
Al día siguiente.
The next day.
Katia's credibility was now on the line. On June the 4th, we had an appointment with God. Our science would test Katia's faith.
That will give us a lot to think about.
A mí también.
And me also.
This 7 News update is brought to you by Australia's leading online bank, NetBank. Haven't you clicked yet?
Good evening. Tonight, the election fallout. Labor does some soul-searching amid calls for change, and Simon Crean most likely as leader. Jenny Macklin puts her hand up for deputy. While John Howard basks in the victory, what's the future for Philip Ruddock? Also, the move on Kabul. The Northern Alliance and opposition forces close in on the Afghan capital. The Taliban still in control of the city, but for how long? More telco jobs on the line. Unions claim Vodafone is preparing to sack half its workforce, up to 1,000 jobs. And remember Val from Prisoner? Well, she's a new woman these days, and it's all because of the aphrodisiac she's been using and promoting. It could change your sex life. And it's official. Greg Norman is a golfing legend, inducted into the Hall of Fame. And we'll have highlights of the drawn cricket test. Join us tonight for the late news.
Can't sleep.
It affects marriages, it can affect jobs.
The nightly struggle for millions, a modern-day epidemic.
I just really have trouble functioning.
Now, the clever new therapies and simple secrets working wonders. 6:30 on Today Tonight.
Am I wrong to hunger? Come along, class.
New Magnum cone from Streets. The adults only cone.
My very good friends, they said it couldn't be done, but it has been. The Dream on DVD. Two big discs with material that's never been released before from Channel 7 vaults of the Olympics in 2000.
Available now from these leading outlets.
Hey, is that my wallet, Jason?
What are you doing, mate? You were going to take money out of my wallet, weren't you? Come on, big shot. Come on, take the money.
Start. Oh, Leopards, Scholar, Jenny, Brennan, Leopards, Mullet, Heimwish, down the line. Ed Barrister's going to get up and win from Leopardsville.
Hey, Jace, are you coming?
Looking back on it, I don't know what was worse, losing the money or losing my mates.
Right, how's it going?
Yeah, $20 in savings, thanks.
Sorry, mate, it's been declined.
That next big win, it's all you care about.
I want you to take it, Jace.
I felt like such a dickhead.
Mate, you need help, you know that? You really need help.
I never thought I'd call gamblers help, but Craig was right.
It's this constant surge for money.
It's been tough, but
it's the way it gets a hold of you.
I'm getting it together.
Think of what you're really gambling with. Call gamblers help on 1800 156 789.
I just want to steal you.
take some comfort from you. I'll pretend everything is just fine.
Every business heads towards a goal. Each has its own way of working. That's why Optus Business will be part of your team to provide whatever communication solution you're looking for. We'll be there to support you all the way. No matter what challenge you're facing, you can rest assured we will help you reach your goal. That's the power of Optus Business. That's the power of yes.
Welcome back to Signs from God. The Roman Catholic feast day of Corpus Christi is a celebration of the Church's central sacrament, communion, a belief that the bread and wine offered to the celebrants is the body and blood of Christ, Corpus Christi, in Latin, body of Christ. It took place this year on June 3rd. Now remember, Katya told Michael that the stigmata would occur the day after Corpus Christi on June 4th. And Michael and his team then returned to Cochabamba, still not knowing if the stigmata would take place. Now, Michael, this is a rather large claim, not a whole lot of stuff to follow here to tell you where you're going to lead. Was there a biblical timetable to let you know what you should expect?
Yeah, we were relying on Christian history quite a bit. And we're told that the suffering of Christ before his crucifixion actually started the night before in the Garden of Gethsemane, where he suffered mental pain and anguish, anxiety. And Katya has told us that she also, before the night before she suffers what she believes to be a stigmata, she has great mental pain and anxiety. So we were most anxious to observe her on the night before, that Thursday night.
It is Thursday morning and Katya has agreed to let us take blood samples.
Yep. Squeeze your finger back there a little bit.
If she does have the predicted stigmata tomorrow, then we'll also take blood from those wounds for comparisons.
Do you need more?
A little bit more.
Katya believes the blood from the stigmata may not be exclusively hers.
When you have these wounds, who do the wounds belong to?
Jesus. Jesus.
That evening, when we return to Katya's house, she appears to be happy and well, but soon she becomes distracted and introspective.
She's beginning to get the anguish you manifest.
Even if I am with many people, I feel lonely and abandoned, like I am not understood by many people. I feel weak, like I cannot do anything.
Tell that person.
Thank you. Yeah.
She's crying.
I will request Katya.
She's crying.
Katya has quietly left us. We find her alone in her prayer room.
Unirte amorosamente a mis dolorosas llagas. Orar en silencio. Escuchar el silencio. Dejar que como el viento mi espíritu respire por todos los recodos de tu alma. Es una maravilla.
¿Eso te ha salido?
Este libro que he abierto.
Santificados. Creo que hecho el grupo para la paz es un...
I start crying for any reason. As the hours go by, it is such an anxiety that I cannot be at ease anywhere. The pain comes and goes, and I start praying. Then there is a very deep sadness.
We still don't know if Katya will have the stigmata tomorrow, but what she says she is feeling now is the emotional suffering which always comes first. It is, she says, the worst time. It seems to us there is little doubt that what she is feeling now is real and profound.
Now, no doubt, Michael, it seems very moving and very disturbing, but again, there are viewers out there who'll say she's faking it, it's psychosomatic. How confident were you being there that she would actually go through the physical stigmata the following day?
I wasn't confident. I did have a feeling that it would happen the next day, but the question of whether it's psychosomatic is a very relevant point. There are doctors, psychiatrists, even priests who believe the external signs of the stigmata can be psychosomatic. So if Katya was somehow mentally self-inducing all this, then her distress that night could not be seen as conclusive proof of the stigmata to come. We had to wait for the Friday. Jesus is said to have started to carry the cross at midday and died at 3 p.m. So those were the hours we were watching for.
It's 12 noon, and Katya is feeling the pain that she believes is the beginning of the stigmata. I check Katya for any visible signs, but there is nothing.
So these are scars from previous stigmata.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing fresh.
As the minutes pass, her pain appears to intensify. Is the stigmata really about to show itself? Katya's spiritual advisor, Father Renzo Cecilo, is by Katya's side. He notices that her forehead has begun to bleed from tiny wounds, which would be consistent with the crown of thorns.
She feels
it's burning.
Bless you, Katya. Excuse me. It's 12:15. And the first mark of the stigmata on the hand is now appearing.
A tiny cross has appeared on Katia's hand.
Descendió a los infiernos y al tercer día resucitó de entre los muertos. Subió a los cielos y está sentado entre la tentación y a los hermanos. Amén.
Wounds now appear on Katia's feet. They start to bleed. Father Renzo intensifies his praying. As carefully as I can, I take the samples we need for our blood tests.
I must stay away from the wound, which clearly has come through very dramatically and very quickly now. Just one more, Katya. Thank you, Katya.
We've been with Katya for more than an hour, and her wounds have continued to deepen. She is bruised and grazed below her left eye. Are these the wounds of Christ?
Just relax your hand there. I'm sorry, Katya.
No. It's my pulmon.
Katya appears to be in great pain. For those of us present, it feels very real and very disturbing. Friends who have come to pray with Katya gently wrap her bleeding hands with bandages.
Llenándose de agua.
Sus pulmones se están llenando de agua. En este momento dice.
She says at this moment her lungs are filling up with liquid.
It is now 2:45. If you believe that Katya is suffering as Christ did on the cross, then she is now reaching the final stages of the crucifixion and approaching death from prolonged torture. Katya's daughter, Tatiana, has arrived to help her mother. It is heartbreaking and frightening. Her mother's pain is affecting everyone in the room.
Jesus. Ah. Я пасу, папе, Лио. Я пасу.
Was so very hard to watch, and on television, you were there, you watched those wounds, Michael, spring from nothing. How did you react being there, watching it with your own eyes?
It was very disturbing. I think a lot of the viewers watching now will feel what I felt then. Maybe being there, it was a little bit worse.
Mm-hmm. So mind-boggling and inexplicable, yet those viewers you're talking about, many of them are saying that is totally self-inflicted. Was there any point where you saw her as she could have done this to herself?
There is no way that was self-inflicted. We were there all the time. We had access to Katya all the time. We saw the wounds start from nothing. The first wound on her hand was a pink dot. And you saw the end result. It simply was not self-inflicted.
Mm-hmm. Now, you're a skeptical journalist. You feeling a bit more spiritual these days as a result of watching that firsthand?
It certainly pushes you heavily in that direction, but you can't rely on your emotionalism when you're making that judgment, or even a feeling of spirituality. So I felt pretty strongly that we still had one more chapter of the stigmata to go.
More proof.
We had to go back the next day and see the condition of her wounds.
Katya, good morning.
Good morning.
Como estás,
Mike?
When I visit Katya the day after the stigmata, I am shocked by her recovery.
You're so much better.
Less than 24 hours ago, she literally appeared to be dying.
See?
Today, she is almost fully recovered. The most striking change is in her face. The wound below her left eye has disappeared, as have the marks on her forehead.
And your hands?
The back of her hands, yesterday open, bleeding wounds, have also healed. Hmm. Two crosses now. And her feet, again, open, bleeding wounds less than 24 hours ago, show wounds just healed, smooth to touch.
So, no more stigmata?
Katya said she received this message from Jesus after her suffering stopped.
I have been preparing you for this day because I needed to reach the world one more time through someone like you to show the world my suffering. Thank you.
So she was on a mission and you were there to help.
Yeah, if you believe that message, it was remarkably strong. Jesus was saying to her, everything you've been through was to prepare you for this day. Your previous stigmata, all the messages, all your work. It was quite a message.
A lot of pressure for one journalist, no? But you actually saw the wounds healed the next day. I mean, you looked at them with your own eyes and you saw that there was just a bare scar. Is that right?
Absolutely. And even on her feet where the wounds you could still see, there was no scab and they were smooth to the touch, mm-hmm. which to me makes the psychosomatic theory quite unlikely. But of course, we still had the blood to test.
Now, what were you looking for in the testing of that blood?
Well, firstly, in being able to take the blood, that was part of our test, to authenticate that the wounds were real. The fact that we could take blood from wounds authenticated that. But then there's the question, if the wounds are the wounds of Christ, could the blood be the blood of Christ?
I'm glad we're not asking any small questions in our special. When we come back, we'll be going back to Forensic Analytical, where blood expert Lisa Calandro will attempt to answer those questions live. Stay with us.
What matters to me at the moment is my family and friends.
My father's in Kilda.
I believe in a lot of pay.
Security matters to me, strong leadership.
And what the government's doing about aged care.
Feeling that there is a future for us all.
Life is to live.
We want to know what's going on around the world.
Sound.
It's the one good thing
I've got.
Makes the world go round.
Well, I will not give you up. I'd really, really love
to stick around.
Giving more people freedom from allergy symptoms than any other non-drowsy antihistamine in the world. Claritine, because life wasn't meant to be sneezy.
Every business heads towards a goal. Each has its own way of working. That's why Optus Business will be part of your team to provide whatever communication solution you're looking for. We'll be there to support you all the way. No matter what challenge you're facing, you can rest assured we will help you reach your goal. That's the power of Optus Business. That's the power of yes.
Pump up the volume. Classic club sounds from the 80s and 90s. 35 tracks, 2 CDs. Relive the best in dance. Get Pump Up the Volume now.
I left my chain now and things go wrong and you're not sleeping right. Don't you come around knocking some lonely, lonely nights. And if you're dreaming of me, I said, now if you're dreaming of me, oh baby, if you're dreaming.
Take advantage of the reward program with more travel choice. Introducing Diners Club Rewards. Call 133-400.
There's some profoundly evil people walking the streets right now. I don't handicap myself with rules.
You ain't no police. Snap that fool!
It can't be like this.
I'm the police. King Kong ain't got nothing on me.
You never know. That's the point.
Training Day.
You could win one of 5 world travel passes for 2 in the Claritine World Freedom Competition. See the entry form on the Claritine stand at your local pharmacy for details.
Welcome back, everyone, to Sign from God. As we just saw, Katya Rivas appeared to experience the stigmata while Michael and his team were present at her home in Bolivia. And while she was bleeding, Michael was permitted to take samples of the blood. Let's go back now live once again to Forensic Analytical, where expert Lisa Calandro is standing by to tell us of the results done on that blood. Lisa, anything unusual?
Well, what we received was samples taken from the hands and feet, and also 2 known reference samples. And those are samples taken from known individuals. We looked at the hands and feet samples first to determine that the samples, swab samples, did contain blood and that blood was human. We then subjected those swabs to genetic testing and determined that, again, the blood was from a female. After that, we looked at the 2 reference samples. One of those was from a male. The second was from a female. That one was labeled K, and it was taken from Katya. The genetic profile that we obtained from the hands and feet samples and from the reference sample from Katya matched across several discriminating DNA markers.
So, Ms. Calandro, this was Katya's blood that emanated from the stigmata, and there was nothing else unusual about that sample?
We could not exclude Katya as the source, and we did not find any evidence of a source other than Katya in that sample.
You have been so gracious to be with us tonight. We thank you so much for your expertise.
Nice talking to you. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Giselle, the blood results were normal. It was simply the filming that was extraordinary.
So you're not disappointed?
Well, how can you be disappointed with a film like that?
It was pretty extraordinary.
If we looked for too much in the blood, we didn't get it. In the filming, we got the extraordinary.
Mm-hmm. And I certainly have never seen anything like that before, Michael. All right, the signs of God we have been investigating tonight are often accompanied by a message. And one constant theme of the messages worldwide over the last 10 to 20 years has been that if man does not turn back to God, there will be a steady increase in natural disasters in our time. Is it just a coincidence then that the last decade of our century has been the most punishing of all? Earthquakes, tornadoes, hurricanes, floods, and volcanic eruptions, natural disasters that have affected close to a billion people in the past 5 years alone, destroying lives and livelihoods.
We have seen an increase in the severities of catastrophes during the 1990s.
Those who add up the cost of these natural disasters call them acts of God. Could they be closer to the truth than they realize? Records of natural disasters have been kept since the year 1900. Fact one, a third of all natural disasters that have occurred in this century came in the 1990s. Fact two, the world has an average of 700 natural disasters per decade, but the 1990s have already been hit by 2,400, three times the average.
Not only are they more frequent, but they are also more severe. In fact, 9 out of 10 of the most costly natural disasters to have occurred in this country have occurred in the last 10 years.
Fact three, floods now affect 130 million people a year, a 700% increase compared to the 70s. Fact four, hurricanes and tornadoes affected six times as many people in the 90s, a 600% increase. As the pattern continues, again comparing the 70s to the 90s, four times as many people were affected by volcanic eruptions, twice as many affected by landslides. Fact five, from 1960 to 1989, there was only 1 year when the United States had 1,000 or more tornadoes. But in the 90s, the U.S. has had at least 1,000 every year. Insurance companies have come up with a new phrase for this late century phenomenon. They call these mega catastrophes, where the cost to property is calculated in tens of billions of dollars. But the cost to human life cannot be so neatly measured. In a remote part of New Guinea last year, a tidal wave literally wiped four villages off the face of the earth. In dollar value, the huts did not amount to much. Yet 2,600 lives were lost that day. A mega catastrophe, or yet another act of God? As we attempt to gain some perspective on what we have seen tonight, let's hear once again from a Catholic Church authority, Father Peter Stravinskas, a noted writer and teacher. Once again, thank you for joining us, Father.
Thank you.
You've just seen this increase in natural disasters at the century's end. Is this a coincidence or a message from God?
Well, of course, we've always had natural disasters, but certainly the frequency and the intensity that you have identified certainly ought to make us stand up and take notice. If we look at all of the extraordinary supernatural phenomena that have been reported, let's leave it just at this century. There is one consistent message. Whether it's Fatima or more recent church-approved apparitions, it is the message of Christ at the beginning of his public ministry. Repent and believe in the gospel. And I suppose that our Lord is saying, or his Blessed Mother, very simply, that perhaps if we haven't been heeding the very simple but profound message of the gospel for 2,000 years, perhaps this is another wake-up call, another opportunity to arouse our sensibilities to the fundamental call to repentance.
Father, what's your reaction to the apparent stigmata of Katya?
I think that my approach would be still extremely cautious. The church has very clear procedures for reacting to these alleged extraordinary phenomena. And from what I can determine, those procedures have been followed very carefully in this case. There is still, as far as I know, no definitive acceptance of the supernatural character. I think it's also important to point out to our viewers that while the church might approve an apparition or some kind of supernatural phenomenon, it does not require Catholics to believe in those phenomena, even if approved. They're declared worthy of belief, which is to say a Catholic is free to believe in it if he chooses, but need not do so.
Father Stravinskas, thanks for your time. We really appreciate that.
Thank you.
And we'll be right back.
Hate
is one thing,
but murder
is another.
Am I a suspect?
Wednesday.
You believe the man murdered your father?
We have got motive coming out of our ears.
Has this Mount Thomas copper taken revenge too far? Blue Healers Wednesday.
Blue from American Express, a credit card with a built-in computer chip. It gets you smart offers and unique discounts at your favorite stores. And with Blue, you can earn points quickly towards your choice of rewards, including points for Qantas frequent flyers. But best of all, Blue is clear. Hello. Get a card with looks and brains. Apply online or call 133-577.
Sanex respects every single inch of your skin. Maintain your skin's natural protection and elasticity with Sanex shower gels. Sanex helps keep skin healthy.
Do you want the gig then?
Rockstar.
Apply for Blue before the 31st of December, and you can transfer the balance from your other credit cards at just 5.99% per annum until it's paid off in full. With Blue, your outstanding balance will shrink a lot sooner. Call 133-577.
This mystery man is turning up in everyone's life.
Who the hell does this guy think he is?
If he gets his way, it may be good news.
And if he doesn't?
Let's just hope it doesn't come to that. Providence Wednesday.
Welcome back once more to Signs from God, Science Tests Faith. Tonight, in what we have shown and tested, we have seen a lot of Katya Rivas, and Michael has recorded more of her thoughts and messages than we have time to show you tonight. But Michael, I am wondering, did you have any insight to the moments when Katya says she actually sees Jesus?
Very much so, Giselle. In our major interview with Katya, it was quite a revelation. We'd already seen Katya say she saw Jesus when we were doing the EEG testing. In an interview later, two things happened. One, at one time, she appeared to be using the words of someone else. When I asked her, she said Jesus was telling her what to say. And two, she said that Jesus appeared to her as we were talking. Again, this is a very important opportunity for viewers to make their own judgment on Katya's credibility. I started by asking her about the appearance of Jesus during the EEG testing. How did he look?
Hermoso.
Beautiful. He was wearing a white tunic without a robe. He was in a white tunic, smiling. His eyes were very light, very beautiful.
Hermoso.
Beautiful.
Katya, tell me what you see when you're looking over my shoulder.
Above your head, Mike. When you're asking me how he looks, He was smiling right behind you so that I could describe him to you.
Is he there now?
Sí.
Do you want to talk with him?
No necesito.
No, I don't need to.
Katya, is this the first time you've seen Jesus like this?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, that I see his full figure.
He was there as if there was a man there?
Sí.
If your judgment is that Katya is telling the truth, then Jesus appears again 20 minutes into the interview. You may care to concentrate on Katya's eyes and look for any unusual reflection.
What are the sins that most offend Jesus?
All sins are an offense to God. There's no such thing as a big lie or a small lie. It is a lie. There is not a small theft or a big theft. It is theft. But I think the thing that hurts Jesus the most is arrogance.
Katya, of all the messages you've received, if you had to make one simple summary of them, what would it be?
That he is always waiting for his children. And that when we say yes to him, he is very prodigal with his love and mercy.
Katya, were you seeing Jesus when you were telling me that?
He was speaking to me about his love and mercy.
Does he have anything else to say?
That he expects that each one of these words fall like dewdrops. To comfort and heal men's hearts. Because the world is full of pain and suffering.
You keep looking.
He says that he is looking at you, Mike, and he is blessing the work that you are doing. He says that these words are for you also.
While we were editing this footage, one of our editors noticed a strange reflection in Katya's left eye. We decided to computer enhance her eyes to get a closer look. As you look at your screen, it's on the right-hand side. There is no doubt that at this moment, the light has changed and appears to be brighter.
It's definitely different. I mean, I don't know what's causing it, but there's a lot more definition in the reflection, and there's nothing that's changed in the camera setup or anything, so whatever it's reflecting is definitely stronger.
Katya says she could see Jesus. Was that his reflection in her eye? That's one question in this investigation that science can't answer. The judgment must be yours.
A reflection of something divine, at the very least, thought-provoking. And before we close tonight, we'll hear from Katya Rivas at her home live in Bolivia.
Up next, Labour soul-searching and leadership. Liberals await a new-look ministry. Closing in on Kabul, Adelaide's festival controversy and a draw in the cricket.
Commodore.
Series 2. For the driver in you.
You know, this country is full of amazing places. But they're not going to come to you.
Thanks to See Australia and premium sponsor MasterCard, you've got even more reasons to get out there right now. Just visit i7.com.au to discover fantastic See Australia holidays. Book with your MasterCard and you could also win $5,000 spending money.
Come on, get out there. See Australia.
Until now, you haven't been able to choose your electricity retailer. But during 2002, you'll be able to choose a retailer that suits you. Each will be offering different price and service packages, so make sure you're well informed before making a choice. Look for a brochure in your letterbox from the Office of the Regulator General. Visit our website or call. It's a kind of power you've never experienced before. The power of choice.
You come around knocking some lonely, lonely nights. Said, if you're dreaming of me, I said, now if you're dreaming of me, oh baby, if you're dreaming of me.
Take advantage of the reward program with more travel choice. Introducing Diners Club Rewards. Call 133-400.
Whether you're buying...
Ultimately, how much can we borrow?
...or selling...
No. ...you're at $600,000.
Auctions can be a nightmare.
Or you get a lot of information thrown at you that's sometimes not always accurate.
It's all to do with understanding the rules and knowing the tricks of the trade.
We've brought the experts in.
We are working for the vendor.
...to help you out.
No one's going to hand it to you on a silver platter.
Who'll win? Who'll lose?
And more importantly, we'll find out why.
Hot Auctions, Tricks of the Trade. A brand new special Wednesday.
Welcome back, everyone. We conclude our special Signs from God by returning one last time to Bolivia, where Katya Rivas has been watching our broadcast live. I'm going to welcome Katya and thank her for sharing her story with us. Buenas noches, Katya. Gracias por compartir su historia con nosotros.
Buenas noches, Giselle. Gracias por presentarme esta noche entre ustedes.
Gracias a usted, Katya. Thank you to you. Mike está aquí. Mike is here. Y él quiere saludarla. He wants to ask you a question, and I'm sure say hello to his friend, Mike.
Katya, firstly, thank you for everything, and what did you think of the program?
Mike dice gracias, y también él te pregunta, ¿ya vio el programa? ¿Cómo te sientes?
Me siento muy emocionada, seguramente, igual que ustedes, y me imagino... que el Señor también se siente igual.
You want to ask her something else, Mike? I'm sure you want to ask her. She has another message.
Yeah, Katya, do you have messages from Jesus?
Mike también te pregunta si puedes ver a Dios en este momento y si tiene un nuevo mensaje para nosotros, Katya.
No lo veo, pero sí tengo el mensaje y lo voy a leer en este momento.
But yes, I do have the message and I will read it right now.
Por favor, gracias.
Querido hombre del siglo XX.
Dear man of the 20th century.
Ustedes me han olvidado.
You have forgotten me.
Vengo otra vez para sacarlos.
I will be coming back again.
De la oscuridad y mostrarles.
To take you away from the darkness and show you.
La fe verdadera.
The true faith.
Vengo a abrazarlos.
I come to hug you.
Quiero colocar mi corazón junto al de ustedes.
I want to put my heart next to your heart.
Para transmitir mi amor a toda la humanidad.
To transmit my love to whole humanity.
¿Quieren abrazarme?
Do you want to hug me?
Tu alma es delicada como el pétalo de una rosa.
Your souls are delicate as a rose petal.
Déjame imprimir en ella mi huella.
Let me impress in it my love.
Katya, a lot of people are watching this program tonight. What do you want them to take away from the program?
Katya, mucha gente está viendo este programa y te gustaría que la gente recordara. ¿Qué quieres que ellos recordaran?
Que recuerden.
I want them to remember.
Que tenemos un Cristo vivo.
That we have a live Christ.
En la Sagrada Eucaristía.
In Eucharistic, you know, religion.
Que Jesús está esperándonos allá.
That Jesus is waiting for us.
Katya. Y que nadie olvide todo el sufrimiento de Jesús por cada uno de nosotros.
And please don't forget Jesus' suffering for all of us.
Katya, nuevamente again, mil gracias for your story, for sharing your intimate story with us. Fue un gran placer, a great pleasure. And Michael, what a pleasure to do this story with you. It's been quite extraordinary. Your final thoughts?
It's changed me considerably, and I hope it gives a lot of people a lot to think about.
From Fox Studios in Los Angeles, I'm sure they will. Thank you so very much. It's been quite a pleasure again. I certainly believe in the power of faith, if nothing else. I'm Giselle Fernandez with the very talented and respected Mike Willesee. From Fox Studios in Los Angeles, thank you all very much for joining us tonight. Signs from God, faith, fact, we will let you, the viewer, be the judge. Good night, everyone.
Enjoyed our special Signs from God. Tomorrow night on All Saints, Malcolm reveals his secret to Terry. Now she must decide on their future together. All Saints, tomorrow at 8:30, followed by Temptation Island. But coming up next, the latest 7 News.